Imagine this. You're driving your car down a desolate roadway, a friend next to you in the passenger seat, and $100 million sitting innocently behind you in your back seat. You just committed the perfect crime, a heist of the world's most unbreakable safe. One night, $100 million. You did it. That's your legacy, and you're pretty much out of the clear. Just a couple more things to clean up and you're good. The law has no idea where you are, let alone who you are. But hold up, you hesitantly turn to your friend in the passenger seat. He looks a bit on edge. No wait, he's panicking. The reality of what he's just done starts to set into his mind, and he mutters the oh so frightening words.
I'm not gonna make it, Sonny.
What are you talking about? Put it on.
I can't do it, Sonny.
Oh, fuck me.
Uh-oh. You're in the clear, and he says this? Your blood is now starting to boil. You're now contemplating pulling a Joker in the Dark Knight and getting rid of that loose end for good. You're not going to let that idiot ruin your legacy, ruin the perfect crime. Your crime? No. But here's the issue. Number one, you don't have a gun or a viable weapon to kill him. Number two, you're not a murderer. Number three, how are you going to cover up such a murder? And finally, number four, you're not a murderer. But this is $100 million on the line right here, not some petty change, and your accomplice is seconds away from dialing the police and confessing to every single sin he's ever committed in his entire life. So, what are you going to do? Well, it's a pretty big decision, I understand that. So I'll give you some time to decide what to do with your panicking friend over there. Because before we come to your critical decision here, let's pull a movie cliche and figure out exactly how we got here in the first place. So you're sitting at a cafe, enjoying an espresso in the Antwerp Diamond District in Antwerp, Belgium. It's nearing the end of 2002, and your name is... But we'll call you N for short. You're a career criminal who's committed a number of small robberies and heists in your time. You consider yourself a master planner, and there is evidence to back it up. And here you are in the world's epicenter for the diamond trade, security guards driving armored cars full of wealth, and dealers with black briefcases handcuffed to their wrists with imposing bodyguards watching each and every step they take. You're like a wolf in sheep's clothing, ready to pounce out, ready to attack. But you're really not planning anything yet. You're scoping the area out, doing some reconnaissance, but you don't have any real plans in mind. Specifically, you are currently playing the part of a jeweler, and you are befriending potential marks, which has allowed you access into offices, workshops, and even vault rooms to inspect merchandise, while deep within your mind, you're taking notes of your surroundings and keeping track of each and every step you take so you can calculate the size and dimensions of the vault. You're also scoping out for security devices and any other special features, because that's just who you are. You're a born thief. But while you sit in the cafe, a Jewish gem dealer approaches you and offers you $100,000 to answer this simple question. Can the Antwerp Diamond District vault be cracked? $100,000 to answer it. And you respond back by saying that you're not sure, because that is the truth. You're not sure. But this question, this $100,000 question, was the catalyst that jump-started your curiosity. So, the next day, you take a pen with a tiny camera tucked into your breast pocket to show the jeweler just how impossible the task is. And because you rented an office in the Diamond Center, and because you keep some of your valuables in the vault, you can gain access into the building and even the vault. So you get in and take all the pictures that your tiny spy camera can hold. A 3-ton steel door, a precise combination wheel with the potential for over 100 million different combinations, infrared and heat sensors to detect the heat from even the slightest of breaths, light sensors, a seismic sensor to prevent anyone from drilling through the door, magnetic plates within the door that sound an alarm if the door creaks by even half an inch, and a final specially curated foot-long key that's one of one that grants access into the vault if you were able to bypass all those other insane security measures. And don't forget the cameras covering every single inch of the vault and its exterior, as well as cameras pointing skyward to survey the airspace above. This is quite literally... So, after obtaining these snapshots and proving to the jeweler the impossibility of such heist, you collect your $100,000 for answering the question and you move on with your life. But this story is far from over, because 5 months later, you receive a call from a blocked number, a familiar voice. Well, spoiler, it's the Jewish dealer who speaks and tells you to meet him at the address he's sending you now. So out of curiosity, you drive to the address, which ends up being an abandoned warehouse on the outskirts of Antwerp, where you meet the jeweler again, and he tells you that he has some people he wants to introduce to you. Weird, you think to yourself, but you just go with the flow. I mean, you are curious. Once inside, you can't believe your eyes. It's an exact replica of the Antwerp vault, down to the smallest details, reconstructed from your photos. From there, you meet three Italian men who are all going by aliases just in case anyone gets caught. The genius who specializes in taking down alarm systems, the monster who simply is, quote, monstrously good at everything, and also because he's a massive human, and then is the king of keys, who, you guessed it, is able to pick any lock. And well, just like that, you have a crew, and it looks like you're planning to pull off... It's go time, as according to the jeweler, in a few weeks, a fresh shipment of De Beers diamonds are set to come in and be stored inside the vault for the weekend. $100 million worth of diamonds. So, you use your criminal mastermind of a brain, and you take your time devising a plan until it is perfect, and just in time too, as the weekend of the shipment comes by. It's now Friday, February 14th, 2003, and before closing, you go to your vault to check out your safety deposit box. The security guards watching the surveillance cameras don't look too deep into it because you're a regular client. There's nothing to be suspicious about. However, on this one specific night, you sneakily spray the heat sensors inside the vault with aerosol spray, weakening the sensors for a short amount of time. You then leave the vault and stand by for the next step of the plan. It's now midnight on that Saturday, and the Diamond District is closed and deserted. You and your team pull up sneakily in your getaway car with an extra member, Speedy, your friend who you vouched for, even though he's susceptible to having nervous breakdowns when scared. The rest of the team just doesn't trust him, but he's your friend, so they just have to let it slide, trusting your word. So your job for now is done. You just need to chill in the getaway car and remain lookout until you receive the call. It's now up to the crew to execute perfectly on your plan. So, the crew breaks into an empty office building to get through to the back, and the genius disables the heat-sensing infrared detectors and covers up security cameras with plastic bags to make their way into the vault room, while an army of armed security guards sit two floors above, ready to pounce on the first alarm. But so far so good. From there, they use a slab of aluminum to disable the door's magnet plates so no alarm goes off when the door is opened. The crew then uses your videos of the combination of the door when it was opened to crack the safe. And finally, the King of Keys inserts the footlong key, which he miraculously found in the utility closet thanks to your videos and pictures, to turn the dial and swing the vault door open. Sitting several blocks away, you get a call. We're in. You look at the front of the building, empty, no police, and you check out the police scanner. Nothing, no activity. Excitement starts to jump inside of you. Is this really happening? You think to yourself. Once inside the vault, the monster controls his breathing and heart rate due to the heat sensors not being fully disabled yet. He has 5 minutes before detection, so he slowly takes 11 steps forward and reaches up to the mainframe, where he meticulously and cautiously strips the plastic coating from the wires, avoiding damaging any of them and setting off the alarm, and he reroutes the incoming electric pulses before they reach the sensors. He did it. All alarm systems inside the vault are down. Your crew is now cut off from the outside world. So, without wasting any time, the King of Keys, using a tiny hand drill because an automatic one would be just too loud, picks the lock of 109 safety deposit boxes, one by one, in complete darkness over the span of 6 hours, emptying out $100 million worth of diamonds, gold, gems, and currencies. It's now 5:30 a.m., and the crew rushes out of the building the same way they got in before the streets fill up again with people as they give you a call, telling you to pull up, so you do so. I mean, that was pretty easy. You guys rush back to your apartment where you celebrate with your crew, as no one is going to know what happened until that Monday when the bankers return back to work, and by then, you'll be long gone. However, we have an issue. Maybe it was too good to be true, because upon opening the special black satchels that belong to the jewelers, you find that they're all empty. They're supposed to be filled with diamonds, but they're empty. What? Your $100 million take is now just worth a mere $20 million. You've been set up. The Jewish dealer told his fellow dealer friends about the heist, and he told them to pull all of their diamonds out of the vault so that they could commit insurance fraud by collecting insurance money on the diamonds after claiming they had been stolen, when in reality they still possess them. He set you up, and you can't believe he did that to you. But you know what? You still have $20 million in front of you, and that Jewish dealer is just about as good as gone. You're not finding him ever again, so what's done is done. Thus, you and the crew split the $20 million and go your separate ways to avoid any suspicion, where you and your good friend Speedy travel down the roadway on your way back to Turin, Italy, with the only pieces of evidence linking you to the heist in a trash bag in the back seat. And here we are again. Well, did you have enough time to think of what to do with your friend Speedy over there who's about to piss his pants? No? What? Come on, I told you to think of what to do with him. I even gave you extra time to think. Well, forget it. Instead, you decide to pull over to the side of the road real quick to find a place to burn the trash for good, since it is the only evidence linking you to the crime, and since it is the main thing that has Speedy on edge. You think maybe burning it can calm him down. So you tell Speedy to sit tight while you scope the area out. You go trekking for some time and you find an abandoned shed, which seems like a viable place to burn the evidence, so you head back to the car, and well, you effed up. There is Speedy, outside of the car, with the trash bag in hand, chucking papers into the bushes and ripping apart videotapes, while a pile of diamonds lay there in the mud, while cash and numerous currencies fly up in the air. The only evidence that links you to the diamond heist now lays scattered all over the forest floor for anyone to find. All because you had to get your friend involved, and all because you did not want to get blood on your hands. But hey, I understand. Killing is a line many never cross. But I'm just saying, $20 million is $20 million. So there you are, picking up as much evidence out of the muddy ground as you can, while scattering the rest all over the forest floor. And well, you f***ed up again, because a couple weeks later, when you think you're free, an old man finds the trash scattered all on his property, and he thinks that it was a bunch of reckless teens who did it. So just like any other old man, he calls the cops, and what do you know? There lay a diamond center envelope, an invoice for a surveillance system bearing your name, and a tiny piece of a salami sandwich with your DNA on it. Well, your run was fun while it lasted, because as the mastermind behind the heist, and all the evidence linking you to it, you get 10 years in prison, all because of two easily avoidable mistakes. The perfect crime, ruined, $100 million, gone. But again, this is just your story. This is only your perspective. The mystery still lives on to this day, because that $100 million in diamonds still have not been found. Who knows who has it? All we know is that you executed the perfect heist, the heist of the century, $100 million in one night, and you let a salami sandwich take you down.